Shamps and giggles, history, news, views, and reviews from a black perspective. Shamps and giggles back for 2024. Oh, my Lord.
I tell you, man. We gotta love it. We gotta love it. You barely know what man say, but music sounds so good.
Big up. Lots to talk about, lots happening. It's a phenomenal show that we have. History, news, news, and reviews. It's just amazing how we're able to pull out these pieces of news that affect us and our culture, what we're doing here in the UK. And it's very, very specific. News that, you know, you'll miss it. You can watch TV all day, but you'll miss it. Why? Because 1% of the information they put out is about. It's for us to collect that and make it 100% of the information, which is what we do here on the show. That's why Shams and Giggles is just phenomenal. Loved on the radio. Big up to all the radio peoples, them across the nation. We're as far as Manchester, we're in Nottingham. Of course, we're down here in London. So the news is spreading, and it's just absolutely beautiful because it's going to continue to grow. Big up Colour Queen in the building. Shugs is there, but Pinky, you reach Lord of Mercy, touching there. Yo, Land is here, Spice. Oh, Lord, Half Pint. Oh, you change your opinion, so teach Lord of Mercy. Come on, Inky, come in. I congratulate some people now.
That's right. So I wanted to also congratulate, before we go on to our main side of things, I wanted to congratulate, do you remember, I think it was last year, or even before that, we were talking about a black bank manager, sent it to you personally, Joe, and we were speaking about a black bank manager, Dale Semper, S-E-M-P-E-R. He was driving and he got arrested by the police. And they arrested him. A bank manager, he'd done doing very well in his career, never had problems with the police or anything like that. And when we were speaking about it, it was that he was taking the police to court because he believes he was wrongly arrested and racially profiled. And it ended up that him being suspended from his bank manager's role, getting about 70 grand a year. Yeah, and we mentioned that being profiled, and he was going to court, and we mentioned in our recordings to the listeners and our immediate members that we will come back to this case once we find out what happens after it's been settled and sorted. Anyway, a few days ago, it has been settled now. And when it was going to, when it went to court and both sides were saying this, that, and the other, his barrister said that you really racially profiled this gentleman because he was black, driving a nice car. When you arrested him, and you know, when they arrest you, they automatically raid your house. Automatically, you're in the police station, and they've already, they go to your house because they've got your keys. Anyone?
No, don't need a warrant.
No, because they're arresting you on suspicion. So of whatever the case is. So if it's firearms or whatever, once they've arrested you, they automatically get some sort of, I don't know if it's dispensation or maybe it is an emergency warrant to go and search your house.
A lot of people
and
don't
anyone
know.
Else.
Suppose your wife and kids are at home. They're just
it doesn't matter. They will enter. So what they've done, they entered his property and they searched his house. They searched his partner's house because she was with him at the time. So they searched the individual because they've arrested whoever's in that vehicle.
Like them, I look something.
Correct. And they also raided his mother's house and put them through all through trauma.
Right.
So what's happened now?
Driving while black, yeah.
Yeah. And that's it. And it had, and on the, you know, they wear the body cameras. It's in the news. It states it. You can always play it. There's a video as well. The The Metropolitan Police, before it went to the last part of the court case, the Metropolitan Police have realized and not put their hands up totally, but put a short piece of their hand up and say, let's halt this case.
Settled on the doorstep.
Let's settle. And they paid him out £1 million
Yeah. A
um,
small
for
token.
wrongful arrest.
Yeah. You know, because the damage to their reputation, because it's already tarnished as is,
Yes.
would have been far worse if it went to court and it got revealed, because then it would have been even more damning. Let's have a sneak preview of the situation. I think this was reported on Channel 4, but let's have a look.
Seven stolen years, Dale Semple would say. Years he and his partner Denise will never get back.
I feel broken. I feel sad that it's taken such a long time. And again, 7 years later, I still haven't had the closure that I would need, because we still actually don't even know where this started from.
Dale, an award-winning bank manager, was arrested in 2017 on suspicion of a raft of crimes, from guns to human trafficking and terrorism. It was dropped 2 years later, without charge and without apology. They began a civil case against the Met, claiming the entire investigation was driven by racism. Yesterday, the force announced it had settled, apologising and awarding them undisclosed damages.
A settlement will never, ever repair the damage that the Met has done to us. They've basically tried to rip our family apart because of their action. And we can't get a sense of why us? Why did we deserve this?
They're no clearer as to why Dale was ever arrested. We first reported the story back in 2020, revealing basic errors in the Met's information. It had said Dale, a British citizen, was Jamaican, that he was living illegally in the UK. Dale says repeated failures by the force to meet disclosure deadlines during the civil case left them running out of money, something they believe was a tactic.
I think they was dragging it out to make us to see how much we'll have and make us run out of money to eventually we just stop and give up.
The Met say there was no attempt to delay the process. It apologised that elements of the case were not handled as well as they could have been, but that they had a duty to act on intelligence. The couple say they've asked twice to meet the Met Commissioner Mark Rowley, who's publicly vowed to tackle racism in the force.
Is it justice?
No.
No, I don't feel it's justice. There's no justice with this. I think we settled. It's called settlement for a reason. I think we settled. I don't feel it's justice. No justice whatsoever.
Justice would be them telling us why they started, first of all. Justice would be actually the Met Commissioner sitting down with us and actually hearing the impact and hearing how stressful and how degrading this experience has been for us. What has been learnt from this case? What are the changes because of this case?
We wanted to start a family. It stopped us. And I feel like we've lost that time and I regret it.
It's been really hard. It has not been easy.
To not start the family that you hoped for is enormous.
Yeah.
They say now the process of rebuilding their lives can begin, but they know they will never quite be the same again.
Wow. Yeah, the
Yeah.
trauma, isn't it? The trauma.
Yeah.
And the
Trauma.
thing is, as you can't get the time back.
No, you can't.
You can't get the time back.
You just
You know,
can't. It's impossible.
a million helps, to be fair, but a million's, you know how much, 7 years, how much have they lost in that time?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
he was a successful guy as was, lost his job, so
Yeah.
70,000 a year, 7 years, that's half a million right there.
Yeah.
And then obviously that's the money he would have had. He didn't have that money, half a million. So now, how does he survive the 7 years? He's got a fine from somewhere. Come on, you know, and as he said, you know, they stretched it in the hopes he might have run out of money, because then you can't
Yeah.
pursue the case.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how they take advantage of people. If you're broke, they take advantage of you in so many different ways. And sometimes you could be right, but you have to walk away because you can't afford justice. Justice costs money.
That's so true.
So,
So yeah, I just thought I'll bring that closure of our when we discussed it prior.
His name was Dale, right?
Yeah.
Big up Dale.
Yeah.
Big up Dale. You deserve Dale Semper. You deserve every penny.
Yeah, and more.
Go and have the picnic them now. Go and have the picnic them. Finally.
Yeah. I hope it really works out for them. So yeah. Give a mention. Can I just? I just want to go back a little touch because we need to give thanks for this one of these people that's always a pensioner who passed. So it should have been in my condolence section, and for a British Caribbean part of the Windrush generation who died is Alford Gardner, or Gardner, if they want to mention it. He was one of the Windrush always fighting for a case. Alford, A-L-F-O-R-D, Gardner. You used to see his face on the news as being one of the Windrush generations that was always looking for compensation.
He's put in... I think they did a picture of him.
That's right. That's right. One of the commemorative pictures that the king and them was looking at, and also he was on his face was also on one of the buses that was parading when they were doing the Black History or the Windrush generation. His face was prominent on one of the London transport buses.
Yeah,
he passed away.
I remember Prince Charles saying to him, because they did do a portrait.
That's right. Him.
I think it is in the palace. I don't know if it's still there, but it was in the palace. Maybe they
keep it
a year, 2 or 5 years. I don't know. There's
a time. Yes, it's in the palace.
But I recall Prince Charles saying to him, "It's a beautiful drawing. And notice, we caught every whisker." And it's got a mustache to die for. Let's just hear a few words from Alford Gardner. Let's just hear about
that
calendar every June. Okay. Yeah. 92 years old. Well done, mate. Well done. I mean, you know what? When someone reaches that kind of age, you know, how many grandchildren, great grands? Well done.
Yeah.
Reviewed.
Yeah.
Alford, big up Rupert. Yeah. And his face is in the palace.
Yes, portrait will always be there, recognizable. Even the laugh he had, let alone his smile.
Happy guy.
Yeah, happy guy. That's exactly what he said.
Yeah. You know, wouldn't change it for the world. We'll go back and do the same thing over again if you had to do it twice.
Yeah. So
that's the kind of life any and everybody wants to live. You could do it over again. Yeah, I'll do the same thing.
Yeah. He did very well out of that. So, so I thought we'll just give thanks to him because Black History Month and so on and Windrush. So it was poignant that we mentioned him on the radio.
Now, as we know, Keith, it's interesting that you mentioned it's Black History Month. It was on the post office tower. I saw it, going around and around. I'm working up there by Euston. For us, Black History is every day of every month of every year.
Yes.
But that being said, that they've given a month for Black history as Black people, it is something to grab by the horns and run with, so to speak, because, it might be every day of every month for us, but that's not for everyone else, is it? Hearing we get a month where Black people are, as it were, celebrated, and if not, it gives us the opportunity to celebrate and define who we are, rather than let people define who we are. We can define who we are, what we do, and how we do, and give tribute to the pathway that we've set. So I personally feel Black people as a whole, because it's all about marketing. Everything's about marketing. How you got to market yourselves. So we've been given this month, and of course, Shams and Giggles, we're going to run with it each week. We're going to put something on as we do.
Yeah.
It's just what we do. But we'll be giving tribute to those that have helped us along the way to get, because all of us, we didn't just wake up one day and become, we're here off the back of everyone behind us, aren't we?
Uh-huh.
So I give tribute and celebrate the Black History Month for what it's worth.
We've got to do that. We've got to continue doing that and don't give up. you know, and hopefully one teaches one, and it just keeps going.
Right.
So, and the benefit for us on Champs and Giggles is that we've got a great audience of listeners.
Yes.
That will all also carry our message across, you know.
That's right. You know, that's the thing, you know, if someone gives you something, don't reject it and be like, I don't know, why? No. You have to look at it and see how you can add value and make it what it's worth. That's the thing. How can you add value to it and make something of it? And that's how anything becomes something that can be treasured and cherished. So, Black History Month, month of October, it is every year.
Yeah.
Let's run with it. By the way, when did Black History Month start in this country? Because I remember we was talking about that before. How many years has it been run? Because people didn't want to acknowledge it in the beginning, did they?
No, they didn't. They didn't want to acknowledge it whatsoever.
Mm. I remember people were... they were a bit put us, like, hang on a minute. You know what I mean, now they're giving us a month.
Yeah.
And it was in 1987 or something. Because I didn't know about Black History Month growing up.
No,
I mean, not in this, in America, yeah. Very prominent, not in this country.
Though. Yeah. And I think it's more potent now that it's like put in the calendars and schools and establishments that they say that October is the month for Black History. So you'll find even on the social media and even on the TV, Netflix or it's ITV, I think it's Netflix, got or Sky, I've got a section on Black History now. There's a tile that you can click in for all Black films now. That's
right. Right. Yeah. So they're giving it its due.
Yeah.
There's a bit of a story behind, or somebody, there's a theme. There we are. There's a theme for Black History Month 2024, which is where we are now. But, you know, it's an ongoing thing. But let's just hear here, because this is an interesting one. Just as we're on this point.
Yeah.
The significance of Black History Month in the UK. Mm-hmm. This would have been something that was put forth on CNN, because Aman Poor is a CNN. She's a CNN news reporter. So this was a couple of years ago, but let's just hear what they said at that time regarding the significance of Black History Month. We can look at what the theme that has been suggested for this year. I don't know who suggested the theme, but nonetheless, let's just have a listen in, a tune, and see what she has to say.
For that placard, the woman carrying that placard with that statement, what about it grabbed you?
I think that the question itself asks all of us to take a bird's eye view on why we haven't asked that question sooner. And also, perversely, why we need to still ask that question. Darcy Bourne, the lady holding the sign, who is an elite athlete and a hockey player for England, who's just started at Duke University, was holding that sign. The paint was still drying, as you can see in the image, and our paths crossed and history was made. It has an emotional reaction where people really think about how they can make sure we never need to ask that question in the future.
And personally, you know, you're making all sorts of history with your photography and where you are at this moment in this uprising for racial justice. What do you think now, several months after it began? And I guess, what do you think about there being one Black History Month per year?
Well, I think, you know, like Pride and many of these months that happen, I live it, and I think this is to remind people that don't have that lived experience that they should have empathy in their hearts to think outside of who they are. So, you know, I don't think Black History Month necessarily has been looked at by people that are non-black in the way that is beginning to be done now. And that's important, because if you live the experience like me and other people that look like me, we know what we've been through. We know what our open wounds are. But Black History Month is for others to also learn about our lived experience so they can understand how they can help fight, eradicate racism.
And do you think that, you know, these last few months have really cemented that? Do you think from everything you're seeing, people you're talking to, that there has been some change in this imbalance?
Oh yeah. I mean, there's no going back. My parents and their parents' generation never had that collective voice. It was always a whisper, because this thing that we all live with called the internet wasn't there. Now we know that there are millions of people from all walks of life and from all races that are coming together to make sure that the ills of our past will not be repeated in the future. And by doing that, we are trying to fix our present. And without question, I am seeing that in every aspect of my daily life, whether it's the children I'm mentoring, whether it's my friends that are taking time to understand the history of the prison industrial complex, or in how the civil justice system has been skewed the wrong way. That is happening at a scale that I've never seen before in my lifetime.
I think you spoke very well. I totally agree with him.
And it's quite interesting, as he said, the ills of our past not repeated. Oh. And we just spoke about Dale, who was racially profiled. Back in the day, that was standard.
Yes.
That was standard. Nobody were getting no compensation. Yes. It wasn't being heard in court. You weren't even taking it to court. And if you did, you just wasn't getting there. So here we are now, where somebody's getting paid, right, compensation for racial profiling. And the Met Police have had to stand down on their claim and recognize that, you know what, let's just settle this out. Recognizing that they wouldn't win in court. Yeah. So has things changed? Yes. The ills of our past, are they being repeated? Well, no and yes, but in the case where they are being repeated, justice is prevailing. We think of the athlete, the Olympic athlete, when she was driving, was racially profiled, dragged out of her car. That's something we had talked about before.
Yeah.
And she also sued.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up, but we will be touching on that afterwards. So you just carry on. Yes, that's correct. Justice is changing. It has changed. Yes, and as you say, can it do better? Yes.
Right.
Will it do better? Yes, I believe it will. Will I be alive for it? I don't know. But all we can say
is that we
hope that it will change much, much, much for the better of our children and our children's children. You know?
Yeah. You know, times are definitely improving. I mean, and, you know, not for nothing, even the show that we have now, where we're talking about Black history, as he said, for us, it's a lived experience. This is what we go for on a regular basis. But Black History Month helps such that others can see what we're going through. Even if it's just that snippet. Mm. But when they're looking at snippet, because we've put out over time our experience, there's a lot to show. Mm. With the show now, just as we're able to reel off events that we've spoken about here on the platform of people that have had ills through the system and that have been able to get some sort of compensation for it. It helps us to be stronger. And you know what? Proud of who we are, what we do. Because back in the day, you might not want to mention it.
Mm-hmm.
You just they used to say we got a chip on our shoulder.
Yeah.
Because why bother? You're not going to understand.
Mm, that's true.
Why bother? You're not going to understand.
No.
But now, we do bother, because whether you understand or not, there, as he said, there's a collective voice that have put forth what's going on with evidence that's been in the news, documented.
Before,
back in the time, it wasn't being documented. It was no. But now it's there. And, you know, all of us got our own profiles
So there's a lot of food. There you are, that's the word, isn't it? There's a lot of food to, to anybody that wants to say not, but there's a lot of evidence to the opposite, isn't it? There's a lot of evidence to say, hang on a minute. No, there is something that's been going on, and there is evidence to that end, and the reports are there. And that's why it's so important what we do, because we, whether we like it or not, we're collecting that information. We're putting it into the black aura, so to speak, the back aura, the back arena, so that others like ourselves can talk the things.
That's correct. And just touching on before we go to our commercial break, is Black History Month was introduced in the UK in 1987. So you were near enough right in what you said. And it was on the 150th anniversary of the abolition of slavery in the Caribbean.
Wow. You know what? Maybe that's a subject to talk about. The abolition of slavery in the Caribbean. What do we understand about that? You know what I'm saying? But you know what? As the saying goes, ain't no stopping us. We'll be back.